Father Assisi, did Jesus have brothers and sisters?
To answer this question, we must first try to grasp the role of Mary in God's divine plan. Did God create Mary only so as to provide a holy womb for His Son? Or was her role far greater than just bearing the Son of God in her womb?
But then, is this greater role of Mary really underlined in Scripture?
Yes, Scripture itself tells you in the second letter to the Thessalonians, where Paul exhorts his followers to stand firm and hold fast to the traditions that you were taught by us, either by word of mouth or by our letter. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 15. In 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 15, Paul further states that the church is the pillar and the bulwark of the truth.
Then are you saying that Scripture does not necessarily need to contain the sum total of all the truths to be believed?
Jesus, the Word of God, is the way, truth, and life. Even though Jesus in His person is the very Word of God, He says, I quote, John chapter 16, verse 12 and 13, I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. When the Spirit of truth comes, He will guide you into all the truth. Jesus seems to be saying that not everything can be said in as many words once and for all. Very simply, there are truths that are contained in Scripture, but whose full potential is revealed only in time through the activity of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit helps us to understand the unfolding of Scripture in history. And this is tradition.
Would the role of Mary in God's plan be part of this tradition you're talking about?
Definitely yes. But that does not mean Scripture itself does not say anything about her in God's plan. Much is being said already, but tradition completes it. Scripture, for example, establishes the virginal conception of Jesus. Let me quote Luke chapter 1, verse 35, where it clearly says, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. Or again, Matthew chapter 1, verse 20, tells us how the angel appeared to Joseph in a dream and said to him, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit.
You have told us that Jesus was born of a virgin. But how do we understand those verses in the Scripture on basis of which some insist that Mary had other children?
I know the text you mean. Matthew 13, verse 55. Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary? And are not his brothers James and Joseph and Simon and Judas? And are not all his sisters with us? There's a similar parallel text in Mark chapter 6, verses 2 and 3. Or even Paul writing to Galatians 1:16, where he says, but I did not see any of the other apostles except James, the Lord's brother. The traditional answer has always been that Jesus had his cousins. But I know that this answer is not easily accepted today. The argument is that the Greek language is so rich that the writers could have used appropriate words to denote cousins. But why didn't they? To answer that question, we need to understand that the Semitic mindset is completely different from that of the Greek. For the Jews, family kinship was very strong. The children of uncles and aunts were all family. They were all brothers and sisters. Therefore, you don't tell the Semitic people, call them cousins, because we call them cousins. The close-knit nature of the family made all the children of uncles and aunts brothers and sisters. Besides, the word for brother and sister in Greek, adelphos and adelphē, occur 343 times and 26 times respectively. Whereas the word for cousin, anepsios, is found only once in Colossians 4:10, which, by the way, was not written by Paul. What do we conclude from this? That there were no cousins ever in the New Testament? Rather, there were. But the only family relationship that existed among peoples of the same generation in the New Testament seems to be brotherhood. Hence, the word for cousin, even if known, was not used.
But Father, some make reference to Matthew chapter 1 verse 25, saying, Joseph knew Mary not until she had borne a son. Or to Luke chapter 2 verse 7, that Mary gave birth to her firstborn son, to point to her subsequent pregnancies.
Biblical scholars no longer claim that the terms until or firstborn are to be read as pointing to subsequent pregnancies of Mary. There is a consensus on these points. Matthew 1:25 does not imply that Joseph knew Mary after she had borne Jesus. The Greek word heios, which means until, does not necessarily contrast before to after. It means that up to a certain point, something happened or not without considering what happened after that moment. For instance, the Greek text of the Septuagint, that is the Greek translation of the Old Testament Hebrew, says in 2 Samuel chapter 6 verse 23 that Michal, daughter of Saul, had no children until the days of her death. This obviously does not suggest that she had children after her death.
What about the firstborn?
Yes, the Greek term is prototokos, firstborn, as applied to males as a unique legal and cultic meaning. Let me give you two texts. The first one from Exodus chapter 13 verse 2. Consecrate to me all the firstborn, whatever is the first to open the womb among the Israelites, of human beings and animals, is mine. Likewise, in Exodus chapter 13 verse 12, Moses adds, you shall set apart to the Lord all that first opens the womb. So who is this firstborn? It is the one to first open the womb of his mother, whether his mother would later have other children or not. In Numbers chapter 3 verse 40, I read, the Lord said to Moses, enroll all the firstborn males of the Israelite from a month old and upward. A month old child could not have been declared a firstborn if he had already been preceded by other siblings. The term firstborn refers above all to the law and is thus applicable not only to the eldest of several, but also to an only son. Perhaps what best answers the question, did Mary have other children after Jesus, is the observation, why would Jesus on the cross entrust Mary to a disciple if she had had other children of her own? From a Johannine point of view, Mary's place in the plan of God is more important than even entrusting her to his beloved disciple. Because Jesus first says, woman, behold your son. And only after looking at his beloved disciple, he says, behold your mother. Perhaps, Vijay, we should end with a prayer. Dear God, you chose Mary, ever virgin, not merely to give birth to your Son, but also as a mother of the Church. O God, help us grasp a role in your divine plan.